First of all, thank you, Nadia Murad, for taking your time to speak with me. In 2014, ISIS attacked your village in northern Iraq and carried out a genocide against the Yazidi community. ISIS is no longer there, but what is the position of Yazidis today?
We're trying our best to rebuild, piece by piece of what ISIS destroyed, but it's so difficult because the ISIS not only destroyed the area, they destroyed the Yazidi people, you know, by taking more than 6,000 Yazidi women and children to captivity and by killing more than 5,000 people. So far we have tens of mass graves that have been discovered in Sinjar. We still have more than 2,700 in ISIS captivity, even though you mentioned that ISIS is no longer there, but where are like those people? My family members, my neighbors, my friends, they are still missing, you know. Last time we heard from my sister-in-law was 4 years ago from Syria, and there was no operation, a specific one, when it comes to like, you know, liberating the area or from ISIS. There was nothing specific for those women to help them to come back. Thousands of Yazidis like me, who girls and women, children that have escaped ISIS captivity, they did it by themselves. You know, they walked miles from Syria, Mosul, and Tal Afar and other area to make it to safety. And unfortunately, many of them, after that experience, they are still in displacement camps.
Like you said, 2,700 people, mostly women and children, are still missing, and some of them are still held in captivity. What do we know about them?
Very little. You know, when there was nothing, no operation to like look for those women and girls, it's so hard to know where they are, you know. We, until today, some of the kids, every few months we hear that they found someone in Iraq, and you know, Iraq has been liberated for years from ISIS, and still we have missing children inside Iraq, and the majority of them, we believe they are in Syria. Some of the big number is in Syria, but we don't know where they are.
So around Sinjar, your home region, there are still over 80 mass graves to be exhumed. Why is it meaningful for the whole community to excavate these graves?
You know, we worked for years we advocate to create a UNITA team to exhume the mass graves. Thousands of people were killed for no reason more than being Yazidis, you know. And it's so important for the community, you know, to bury their loved ones. And this year, in February, I was able to go back to my village, and after they brought back 103 bodies that they were identified, and two of them were my brothers, my nephew, three cousins and friends and my teachers. You know, it was a small village. They're all my relatives, there's a lot to be done. You know, that was just a little bit of it.
You participated this ceremony yourself. What was it like?
You know, it was very difficult. After, you know, 7 years later, you just go back and live the experience again. You know, remember everything. My brothers were very young men, and they were fathers too, and they left more than 21 kids behind. But I was happy and I was lucky because I could be there for my brothers. You know, there were some people they brought back from my village, and there was no one there from their family members to be there. It was sad, but also it means a lot to me to just be there for the last time for them. Yeah.
About the crimes that ISIS committed against women, you have described that the use of sexual violence was no coincidence. Could you tell me more about that?
You know, when ISIS attacked the Yazidi community, it was different from all other communities in Iraq and Syria. They had a special plan for the Yazidi community. Other communities, for example, Christians and other in Iraq, they were able to flee, you know, and no women in Iraq was captured by ISIS more than Yazidis. You know, they were just Yazidi women, and they knew that women, you know, means a lot to the community. It's like the dignity, to take the dignity of the community is to take their women and girls. And they focused on that. They killed men and older women, and they took young girls and women to captivity. And they knew that the only way to destroy the community and to make sure that the community will never go back is to do it through women and children. And so far they have succeed, you know, they succeed to just eradicate us, you know, and they're now thousands of them, they just walked free with what they did to Yazidi women and children.
And that is exactly what you are also working for, to bring those ISIS perpetrators to justice for their genocide and the sexual violence that occurred. How is that proceeding?
You know, we've been working, it's the most important part of our work. We have a great lawyer like, you know, Amal Clooney. She's been working with us tirelessly in the past for years, collecting evidence, talking to survivors, and, you know, we have, as I said, we have all the evidence. We've been working on it. We have not seen one ISIS member that had been held accountable yet, but we have evidence, and we're not gonna give up on what they did.
You've survived the sexual slavery in the hands of ISIS and the loss of many of your brothers and your mother, yet now your whole advocate work is about talking about your experiences and things you've gone through. What is it that keeps you going?
You know, it's the community. It's my family. It's what happened to me. I had a decent family. I had a life. I had education. I had a farm, and everything was taken from me and from my community for no reason. And I like seeing my community just being, after they escaped ISIS and survived ISIS, they just disappearing, you know, cannot go back, and we are still paying the price of what ISIS did, and we need to see and understand the root causes of violence that was used against women and girls, so that what happened to Yazidi, what happened to me, will not happen to any other community.
Thank you so much for the interview, Nadine Murad, and all the luck with your work.